Hi everyone, my name is Mary Chuah. I'm a registered counselor and currently I'm teaching counseling subjects in the Department of Social Science. In a recent study conducted by the American College Health Association in 2018, only 1.6% of college students reported that they felt no stress in the last 12 months. Locally, in Malaysia, a study was conducted on stress and mental health of undergraduates at a private higher learning institution. A total of 350 students participated in this study, and findings revealed that 50% of the students suffered from some kind of depression. This study seemed to indicate that many students experience stress during their course of study. What is stress? Stress is a normal and necessary part of life. It is our fight or flight response to challenges we see in the world. While stress affects everyone in different ways, there are two major types of stress. Stress that's beneficial and motivating, which is also known as good stress, and stress that causes anxiety and even health problems, the bad stress or distress. What are the characteristics of good stress then? Good stress or eustress has the following characteristics. People who experience good stress feel motivated and are able to focus their energy on performing their tasks. It is short-term. People who feel good stress find themselves in a situation where it is within their coping abilities. People feel excited. And as a result of the stress, people improve performance. An example of good stress or eustress would be studying for a new qualification over a period of time. It is sustaining us as we work towards something bigger that will move us forward in life, like a new qualification. In contrast, distress or negative stress has the following characteristics. Distress causes anxiety or concern. It can be short-term or long-term. People who feel stress or distress find themselves in a situation where it is outside of their coping abilities. People who are distressed feel unpleasant. When people feel distressed, their performance will drop. Distress can also lead to mental and physical problems. For example, a sudden loss of a job. Now, let's look at what are the symptoms of stress. Stress can affect our body, mood, and behavior. Some of the bodily symptoms are headache, muscle tension or pain, chest pain, fatigue, change in sex drive, stomach upset, sleep problems. When we feel stressed, it affects our mood too. Sadness or depression, irritability or anger, feeling overwhelmed, restlessness, lack of motivation or focus, anxiety. In terms of behavior, when we feel distressed, we tend to have angry outbursts. Overeating or undereating, drug or alcohol misuse, tobacco use, social withdrawal, exercising less often. For the past few decades, many psychologists have conducted studies to find ways to help people cope with stress. And today I will share with you three simple ways that you could use to help you cope better with stress. The first way is good time management. We often hear people complaining about them not having enough time. I got no time to do this, or I am busy. And these people feel extremely stressed when they have endless tasks to complete. There are many reasons that people complain about not having enough time, and one of them is due to poor time management. So let me share with you a simple yet practical way to manage time more effectively. Let's look at this priority matrix that is developed by Dwight David Eisenhower. This matrix could help us know what task needs to be completed first as compared with other tasks. Good time management is all about prioritizing. What it means is you need to know what is the most important and urgent task that you need to complete first, followed by the less important and urgent tasks. Have a look at the first quadrant, which is the urgent and important quadrant. Urgent and important tasks demand you take action quickly. These items typically have visible deadlines and consequences for stalling on taking action. Most often, these are either things that were sprung on you from an external source or things that you put off until faced with a looming deadline. Either way, they require a crisis mode response. For example, overdue assignment which needs to be completed as soon as possible. When we spend too much time completing tasks in quadrant 1, it can lead to increased stress and burnout. Now, we look at the second quadrant. Activities that are not urgent but yet they are important. Not urgent but important tasks are activities or tasks that help you achieve long-term goals. Some of these tasks may not have a deadline, or the deadline is on a later date. So it is easy to put them off in favor of more urgent tasks. However, completing these tasks can have a much greater effect on your long-term effectiveness in completing your goals. For example, doing an assignment that is due in a month's time. Start working on the assignment even though the deadline is a few weeks later. Once you have completed your assignments, you could continue doing other important tasks that are not urgent. For the third quadrant, we look at activities that are urgent and not important. Urgent but not important tasks are best described as busy work. These tasks or activities require immediate attention. For example, your friend asks you to help him collect a parcel from the post office immediately as he is busy. Or your classmate asks you to check her assignment report for her as she has to attend a meeting. Spending too much time in this quadrant can feel like you are doing things you should do rather than what you want to do. Hence, you are encouraged to delegate others to do the tasks. For the fourth quadrant, which is the not urgent and not important quadrant. Not urgent and not important tasks are time-wasting activities that should be ruthlessly cut out. For example, watching TV for hours, or mindlessly refreshing social media and scrolling. Spending most of your time in this quadrant will make you become less productive, and eventually you will feel stressed as you could not complete other tasks that are important. So to summarize, to maintain time effectively, try to reduce time spent in quadrants 1, 3, and 4, and expand quadrant 2. In other words, always schedule a time to complete tasks that are important and not urgent. This will definitely reduce your stress. Let's move on to the second way, which is to practice mindfulness. What is mindfulness? According to Jon Kabat-Zinn, founder of mindfulness-based stress reduction, mindfulness is awareness that arises through paying attention on purpose in the present moment non-judgmentally. Mindfulness is a state that can be brought on through practice. It involves awareness and impartiality about what we gain from this awareness.
And then all of a sudden what is happening, what's coming online is a whole other way of being.
The benefits of practicing mindfulness are, number one, it can reduce stress. Number two, it improves working memory. Number three, it improves focus. Number four, it could help to reduce emotional reactivity. Lastly, it could improve cognitive flexibility. What are some of the ways to practice mindfulness? While meditation can help to increase mindfulness, people can practice mindfulness while doing any daily activity. Whether students are studying, spending time with friends, or sitting in class, walking, eating a meal, they can practice mindfulness by simply bringing a sense of awareness to everything they are doing. Next, taking deep breaths. Taking deep breaths helps to slow down the mind and heart rate, which can go a long way toward alleviating stress. When students are feeling anxious about an upcoming paper or test, taking deep breaths will help them calm down so they can focus on the task at hand. Maintaining a gratitude journal. When students are stressed out about school, they may focus on their negative feelings, which can eventually lead to depression and anxiety. Keeping a gratitude journal can cut through the negativity and remind students of the good things that are going on in their lives, despite the stress. Finally, the last way is exercise regularly. Many studies have found that one of the benefits of exercising regularly is that it helps to reduce stress. It also can improve physical health by reducing risk of major illnesses such as heart disease, stroke, type 2 diabetes, and cancer by up to 50%. The types of exercise you could do are aerobic exercises such as jogging, walking, swimming, and cycling. I hope you have enjoyed watching this video. So let's apply these three simple ways of managing stress so that you can have a happy and healthy life in college. All the best to you. Bye.